Good morning. And welcome to our 146th anniversary. It's pretty exciting. It's like our birthday. And we're so excited that you all have joined us today to be here for our anniversary service. And everybody who's online, welcome to you as well. We couldn't be happier to have you here today. So this year, as I mentioned last week and in an email, again, if you don't get the emails, you can let us, the office know and we'll sign you up. Instead of purchasing a cake that we have to, you know, wrap in plastic and take with us as we go and not have any social event, we've decided to use the money for that and make a donation to the food bank. So right in the back next to the offering plate, there's another basket and there are envelopes. And if you wish, you can make a contribution as well to the food bank and it will all go there together. As we know, or as most of us have probably heard, the food bank has had some extra demands on it in this last period of time. And one of the things that I hear a lot, I really like to buy things for the food bank when I go out, but they can do so much more with the money than we can, because when they buy in bulk, they can get things for even cheaper. So while food is very helpful, money is also very helpful. So today we're very honored to have Reverend Margaret Sagar with us today, right over here. Reverend Margaret was the minister here from 1994 to 2005. I just found out today she actually baptized Anne. Right, Anne? Do you remember that? Yeah, I knew you would. And it's such a privilege to have her here worshiping and leading worship with us today. So let's say welcome to Reverend Margaret. I let her borrow back the stole that was originally hers, and she passed on to me, which is really great because it's all the doors from the houses that were one time made by all the families here at St. Andrews, and they made the stole. So it's a very special stole, and I'm so happy she's wearing it today. So just a reminder that we have paint night. Here's the painting that is going to be this Friday, on November the 19th. It's our regular youth group night, and then we're welcoming anybody else who'd like to join in, but I need to know by today. So the sign-up sheet is outside on the bulletin board, and there's a lot of supplies involved in this one, and I don't want to buy too many and then, you know, not use them. So if you are wanting to come, please sign up. It's on the bulletin board. It's 6:30 to 8 on Friday evening. Next, we're starting a new choir here, which is very exciting. So we're going to start this choir. It's not going to be called Joyful Noise, because I already got an email from another choir that said, are you going to use that name? Because we already have it. And and so, but it is very specifically for people who love to sing, with a special invite to, you can go to the next slide there, Louise, to people who have disabilities and intellectual disabilities. And so we've sent it out as widely as we can in the communities of those folks so that they'll get word. But it's for everybody, including our choir. So we need to have lots of strong singers and then some who, you know, maybe like to sing but aren't as strong. And Sheena is, are you here? Are you behind me? She's down there. Sheena will be directing it, and Elliot will be helping, right? Yeah. And so we're really excited to have this. It starts Tuesday evening, 6:30 to 7:30. Everybody is welcome to come. It's a fun choir. It's not about performance. It's about just coming and singing. We're going to sing probably Let It Go, right, Anne? Yeah. Probably O Canada. Yeah. That last week was Anne's favorite worship service with O Canada in it. And lots of great music. Also, next week there's going to be a French toast breakfast, and so that's on November 21st, so please sign up if you'd like to attend, and all the information is on the bulletin board. And the Local Outreach Global Concerns Committee is doing a takeout soup lunch on November the 28th. And proceeds from this soup lunch, which either you can buy and take a lunch home for yourself, or you can pay for a lunch that would be taken to Hub House, And all the money that's raised from it will go to support a family through the Christmas Index. So please see the announcement that's in your bulletin and also the information on the bulletin board. And finally this week, we received a thank you letter for our donation to the mission and service of the United Church of Canada. So last year we gave $20,950 as a congregation. And this is one way that we can spread God's love in the world. So let's say congratulations to ourselves for that. So now it's time we'll take a moment to quiet our minds and to prepare our hearts to worship God with our centering song. So let's begin our worship this morning by acknowledging that we are in the Peace and Friendship Treaties territory. The land on which we gather, live, and worship is the traditional territory of the Mi'kmaq and Wabanaki Confederacy people. Now please join our voices in saying our statement of reconciliation. May we live with respect on this land and in peace and friendship with its people. Come to this sacred place that we create together with the Spirit. Come to this holy place
that has welcomed generations before us and will welcome generations after us.
Come to this sanctuary
that is a safe space for all, filled with people who care for one another.
Come to this moment in time
with praise, with love, and love.
And now we will light our Christ candle, and we light the candle not to invite Christ into our presence, but to remind us that Christ, the Prince of Peace, is always with us. Let us pray. God of the way, you are the road we travel and the sign we follow. You are the bread for the journey and the wine of arrival. Guide us as we follow in your way, holding on to each other, reaching out to your beloved world. And when we stray, seek us out and find us. Set our feet on the path again and lead us safely home. In the name of Jesus, our companion, we pray. Amen. And now I invite you to rise as able as we sing, Let Us Build a House.
Thank you. hello, everyone. Whoops, chair was lower than I thought. Let's see what I have in this bag. Have a look around. Oh, these people. Do you recognize it? If you look all around you, Mike, do you know those people back there? All these people. Can I take this mask off? Because I can't speak with it on. Okay, we'll let you do that. Oh. So, do you know where we are now? I think I came here with Skipper. That's right, you came here with Skipper. It was a long time ago. Yeah, I miss Skipper. Ah, I miss Skipper too. We both do. So, there are children here. Are they the children that I used to talk to? No, they're not the children you used to talk to. They're all grown up now. Some of these might be their children. I know there are some children of people I knew when they were younger. Wow. And they're still coming to St. Andrews? Yes, isn't that wonderful? They're still coming to St. Andrews. So, what have I come here for today? To talk to the children about Jesus. Oh, okay. I love Jesus. Jesus loves me too. What do the children know about Jesus? Can you tell me anything you know about Jesus? We're a long way away from each other. Actually, I can take this off too, I guess. Can the children or anybody, the big children too, tell me what they know about Jesus? Nobody knows anything about Jesus. That's terrible. I thought these people were supposed to be followers of Jesus. So I think you're going to have to tell me what you know about Jesus. What do you know, Cecil? Oh, we didn't tell you everybody your name, did we? What's your name? Cecil. Can you say hello, Cecil?
Hello, Cecil.
And somebody has a hand up over there. What are you going to tell us? Son of God. Thank you. Yes, that Jesus was the Son of God. People recognized him as being so wonderful. And somebody else has something to say now.
He was born in Bethlehem.
That was at Christmas, wasn't it? Christmas. I like Christmas. You do? Is it Christmas yet? No, not yet. I like presents and food, but it's more than that. Yeah, I know. Yes? My hearing's not as good as it used to be. What was that? Told us stories, that's right. He was a good storyteller, wasn't he? And he was a good man. What else did he do? Any other things? He taught us to love one another. Yes. That's right. He taught us to love one another. And people didn't like him because he said that, did they? The people didn't like him. So what happened? He was arrested and he was put on a cross to die. Yeah, that was very sad, wasn't it? Very, very, very sad. But what happened? Jesus didn't stay dead. The tomb was empty. 3 days later, he got up and was alive again. Jump for joy! Jump for joy! Okay, yes, that was exciting. And so his people
All his followers decided that he was such a special person. And where is Jesus now? Jesus is here, everywhere, everywhere. And where else do you think he might be? Oh, he's in my heart. Is Jesus in your hearts too? Yes? And I think Jesus has been very active in this community of faith. It's so vibrant with all the things that everybody's doing. That's wonderful. Okay, shall we go now? Yeah, I think it's time. Perhaps we'll end with a prayer and then we're going to sing a song. So let's say a prayer together. You can say after me. Jesus, we thank you. For being with us, teaching us how to love, and how to live our lives, to be kind and good and caring to everything. Amen. And now we're going to sing a song, I'm Gonna Live Like So God, no, what's it? That's right. I'm going to live so God can use me anywhere, anytime.
Good morning. Our Hebrew Bible reading today is from the book of Psalms, number 145. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, and great to be praised. His greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall laud your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works, I will meditate. The might of your awesome deeds shall be proclaimed and I will declare your greatness. They shall celebrate the fame of your abundant goodness and sing aloud of your righteousness. All your works shall give thanks, O Lord, to you, and all your faithful will bless you. They speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power to make known to all people your mighty deeds and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. May we hear the Spirit, what the Spirit is saying to the church in this reading.
And a reading from the Gospel of Mark. As Jesus came out of the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what large stones and what large buildings." Then Jesus asked him, Do you see these great buildings? Not one stone will be left here upon another. All will be thrown down. When he was sitting on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter, James, John, and Andrew asked him privately, "Tell us, when will this be, and what will be the sign that all these things are about to be accomplished?" Then Jesus began to say to them, "Beware that no one leads you astray. Many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and they will lead many astray. When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. This must take place, but the end is still to come. For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places. There will be famines. This is but the beginning of the birth pangs." Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Amen. Oh, I love the baby in the picture. Thank you. That's lovely. So it's a real delight to me to be back here today after 16 years, although I did come to the service that celebrated St. Andrew's becoming an affirming congregation, something that had been begun years before. And I am just so impressed by how vibrant this church looks. I think it has something to do with something else I'm going to say in a minute, so I think I'll keep that for the time being. But it's just amazing what you are doing and what you are up to. And I loved seeing all the photo books at the back, photo albums, and all the other signs of what's going on here. That's just wonderful. And I know that as I stand here today, there are many whom I knew who have passed away into God's eternal life and love, including Skipper, my husband. And I remember all of them with deep affection and appreciation. And I know too that some are ailing in nursing homes, perhaps not knowing anyone, which is also so sad. And some have moved away whom I knew as well. And there are some here, and perhaps watching online, whom I lovingly held in my arms for baptism and or laid hands on for confirmation, and they are grown up now. And perhaps some at whose marriage I officiated. Such is the journey of life. And it is certainly a joy to know that faith is being passed along from generation to generation, as the psalmist says. And for that, we praise God with grateful hearts on this 146th anniversary. And that sharing of faith, which continues, has empowered and will empower you to continue your strong ministry now and into the future. A little historical thing, but some of you may remember, Hope Ogilvie told me how, as a little girl, she and her mother used to go to the Methodist Church on Pleasant Street. And then one Sunday morning in June 1925, they walked a different route. "Where are we going?" she asked. And mother replied, "To St. Andrew's. The Presbyterian Church and the Methodist Church are now the United Church of Canada. And from now on, we will be attending St. Andrew's." And Hope remembered the swish of her mother's long taffeta skirt as she walked along beside her. And I recall from the archives that particular church union came about with some ease because the lay leaders at those two churches were close friends and colleagues at the Agricultural College. Some of you will fondly remember Hilda Wright, who was the first woman in Truro Presbytery to be a clerk of session, and Grace Bethel, whose faith and bequests have had a continuing impact on St. Andrew's. A few of you may recall Walina Brown,
the first woman from this church to be ordained in 1953. And she came to an anniversary service when I was here. And I remember Tom Smith, who worshipped here from his childhood to his death. And there are so many other people whom you know and you remember, and I do, who played a role in this congregation, in the building up of what it is today. But if we named them all, we'd be here all day, and I don't think I'd be very popular. In the gospel I read just now, one of the disciples comments on the splendor of the magnificent temple in Jerusalem, and Jesus speaks of it tumbling to the ground. The building will not endure, but faith did endure beyond that building, the Hebrew faith, the Jewish faith. But it is also the person of the crucified and risen Christ who inspires faith to survive beyond bricks and mortar. And part of the history of this church is the demolition of an unsafe building, so it was thought. I've heard contrary feelings about that. And the creation of this sanctuary and this multi-purpose space with the meeting place and the chapel. And this building has, in fact, served you really well as a home base from which to pass faith on from one generation to another, to declare God's mighty and awesome deeds in your various ministries and witnessing both here and in the wider world to the abundant goodness and righteousness of God's glorious kingdom, which will endure throughout all generations, as Woody read to us. I did my own little trip down memory lane the other day, looking through the book of messages that I had received when we closed my covenant with you. And I am certainly very grateful for the many happy, exciting, and the challenging things that we did together. And many of those things have continued and built and grown, which is just wonderful. I enjoyed looking at the book of Mozambique when Trinky and I, you remember, went to Mozambique. And I meant to bring something with me, and I'm afraid I forgot and left it at home. But another time, maybe. Two little stories about my time here. One hot summer afternoon, it was our turn to lead worship at one of the nursing homes. And I was wearing a long cotton dress. And as I was greeting the residents afterwards, Chella remembers this, one woman said to me, "I've never seen a minister lead a service in her nightdress." I think we giggled about that for a long time. And then one variety show, I donned a beautiful auburn wig. Do you remember that? And I saw the puzzled looks and heard the whispers, "Who is it?" And I was going to sing with Chris, he didn't know I was going to wear this wig either. And nor did Linda, who was playing the piano. So anyway, I saw all these puzzled lips and looks, and people were whispering to each other, "Who is it?" But then when I opened my mouth and my voice was heard, it gave the game away. But that was fun. And another memory, I remember we were having a focus in worship and Sunday school on caring for God's creation. And I can still see the children coming down the aisle here with two or three of them wearing large adult-sized snowshoes. And they were illustrating the size of Canadian environmental footprint. I think it was Glenn who did that. Was it you? Was it Glenn? Where are you, Glenn? I can't see you. Was that you who organized that? Maybe it was Bill Lycan. I can't remember. Anyway, that sticks in my mind. And one of their messages, I remember, was to save water by not running the tap while you clean your teeth. And I remember that when far too often I forget that lesson. So I think you've gone on caring for creation and caring for earth since then, and so have I. And those of you who know me will not be a bit surprised that I'm still passionate in trying to make change to create a more just, more peaceful, and sustainable world. And this is, in fact, the very essence of the Christian Church's mission, isn't it? In 2009, I was part of an interfaith group in Halifax that advocated for COP15 in Copenhagen. And I made this poster with photos of my grandchildren and a great-grandchild and children in Bermuda. These children are now 11 years older, and we still haven't done what we were supposed to do, right? COP26 has made a little bit of progress, but we are still far from where we need to be. And so also, for the sake of the children, I have become a raging granny. Something else which perhaps doesn't surprise you, I like to rage and rant. But I think it's really good to have some fun while dealing with very serious issues. Sadly, because of the pandemic, we have only had 2 gigs, both with the Voice of Women for Peace. But you know, one of the good things that has come out of the pandemic is that I've been able to learn from webinars on these kinds of topics and to join Zoom meetings and book studies and prayer groups, and even making new friends whom I haven't yet met in person. I'll take this off because it kind of flops around my eyes. So pandemics. There's a likelihood of more viruses coming as humankind encroaches on the wild places of Earth and destroys millions more species. A new bacteria that have lain dormant for millennia may emerge out of the thawing permafrost and the ice in the north. The world today seems to be in the kind of mess that Jesus describes in that reading, wars and earthquakes and famine. And further in this chapter, Jesus tells of yet more horrifying signs. And we know that today there are wars, earthquakes, and famines, along with heat domes, fires, floods, drought, hurricanes, tornadoes, volcanoes erupting, tsunamis, and a multitude of injustices. And while so-called natural disasters have happened before in human history, there is a really terrifying difference right now. We human beings have 2 swords hanging over our heads that threaten humankind with extinction: nuclear weapons and climate change, each of which would make Earth inhospitable to life as we know it now, and especially uninhabitable for our species. We live in what the scriptures call a kairos moment, a divine opportunity, a crisis time, a time for decision, a pivotal time to draw us back from the brink. Perhaps some of you have seen a recent animated video of a dinosaur plodding into the United Nations Assembly in New York and standing enormous at the podium saying, "I know a thing or two about extinction. It was a giant meteorite that did me in. But you are doing this to yourselves. Stupid. Incomprehensible. Do not choose extinction." And do we really want to choose extinction? I don't think so, and I pray not. Earth would continue in new ways without us. And part of the problem is that we have forgotten our place in the universe of God's creation. Think of the story of creation told in Genesis. We human beings were the last to be made. But some people came to believe that because of that, we were the pinnacle of God's creation. But you know what? We were the last because we needed everything else that God had created in order for us to live. Air to breathe, water to drink, the fish, all the other creatures, and the animals and so on, and the plants. We needed all of that for us to have life. And we can't exist without those gifts of the Creator. And indigenous cultures all over the world have remembered that for thousands of years, while so-called enlightened Western civilization have forgotten it in the last few hundred years. And in Genesis 2, we have a different version. First man made out of a handful of earth. And we know that the name Adam means earth in Hebrew, Adama. And we know now that the Big Bang theory of the universe, all matter in the universe, including on earth, comes from stardust. You and I are stardust and water. and we are totally dependent and interconnected with all other life forms. This is the web of life upon which we are wreaking havoc, and we are being led astray by worshiping the idols, false messiahs of our culture and society, money and profit at whatever cost, consumerism, encouraging us to want so much stuff that we want big houses with large storage closets and rooms, and even lockers outside of our homes. And we are also led astray by the powerful military-industrial machine and the false promise of security through sophisticated weapons, including nuclear. And despite the fact that military power cannot save us from the existential threat of our time. I have a hard time imagining how some of those who wield enormous power in the world can live with themselves as they stand in the way of our true security. And true security, lasting security, is dependent upon our ending fossil fuel emissions, upon loving care for nature and for every living being on earth, with justice and dignity and respect and right relations and protection and clean water and air and food and health care and shelter and education for all. It is these which will make for peace and the continuity of human life on earth. And we know that there are solutions to our need for energy to power our machines and warm our homes. We need the will to heed the science and act at all levels. And there are no boundaries in the atmosphere or in the oceans. What happens in one place affects everywhere. And all matter is sacred. In Jesus, the Word of God, the wisdom of God, became flesh and dwelt among us and made of the same stardust just as we are. Why? To show us the full potential of being human and the fullness of life and the way of love. And all that I just said can be summed up in that word love. Love for every gift of creation, love for each other, love for our own self. And thus we love God, the holy mystery of life and love. We should all be in awe when we reflect on that. So in that gospel reading, Jesus says that these signs, these horrors that we live through, are but the beginning of the birth pangs. These are the birth pangs that bring forth new life. Generation after generation experiences that possibility of birthing a new life, a transformation from all that we used to call, and don't use very much these days, that word sin. The attributes that do not build up, but tear down, alienate, and isolate. We cannot escape the consequences of human behavior. There is no magic wand. But there is a cross that redeems life from the principalities and powers of sin, of evil. And there is resurrection and rebirth. Jump for joy. Every person who desires to walk the way of love and the way of Jesus is called to be a midwife, to bring to birth within oneself the fullness of the image of God in which we are made, and to bring to birth in the world all around us a transformation of earth to come that place where love reigns, the kingdom of God. Thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven, we pray. So we are called to be participants and co-creators in that prayer of Jesus. I'm very partial to that image of the midwife. I worked in a maternity hospital when I was young in the late 50s and early 60s, and I very much appreciate the television series called Call the Midwife. I don't know how many of you are familiar with that, but it was originally based on the memoirs of a real midwife who worked in the East End of London, a very poor area, in the 1950s. And she worked with an Anglican order of sisters, nuns. And I enjoy it because it shows the faith-filled sisters of Nonatus House are being so compassionate and so focused on unconditionally loving each person who comes to them. And there is both joy and sorrow in their work and in the stories that reveal the injustice and the suffering in the world, in London. The old workhouses that used to exist, the slum conditions of bombed out London, and the poverty and diseases that are no longer a threat to us because we have vaccines. And races, they've also tackled things like abortion, the arrival of the pill, thalidomide, racism, injustice, and recently nuclear radiation. And throughout these stories, these characters endeavor to bring new life into the world through the labor of the women whom they help to birth their babies. But in addition, they themselves labor to midwife a new and better world, a world of dignity and respect for all, of safety and security where all are welcome. That house that we spoke about in that hymn, not only this building or even our own homes, but the entire world, the whole earth is our house where love can dwell and all can safely live. So that is who we are each of us called to be, and as a community of faith, to be midwives of the sacred new life that God wills for us, where love reigns, the kingdom of God. Jesus showed us the way, and it's not easy. It is hard labor, like childbirth, but it will bring us deep joy and perhaps sometimes sorrow as we bring to birth, each in our unique way, the love that the world so desperately needs now, if we do not want to choose extinction. The love that will enable the human race to survive on Earth, that will unfold all life and point to the mystery of love and life that is the heart of the universe. And it is to this hope and this holy task that here in St. Andrew's, you are called through all of you, both individually and collectively. May it be so. And to she who is, the Holy One who brings each of us to birth, be all honor and glory, all love and all praise. Amen.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm going to talk about our project this morning, but before I start, I think it's extremely interesting that it was when Margaret was here that this project began in 2007. So everything goes around, doesn't it? Anyway, I'd like to draw your attention to the beautiful display of dolls and jumpers and hats. They have been knit by members of St. Andrews and by the wider and caring community. John and I even made a trip to Dartmouth to pick up a few bags of the finished items. They are colorful and fun to see, so the items are already providing some joy. They also keep fingers nimble and minds busy while reclaiming and using up bits of yarn. However, the bigger job for the dolls, jumpers, and hats begins as they get used for packing among medications and much-needed furniture items for countries where they are most needed. The dolls are then given to the children in these areas, which gives a child her or his own personal item, something which may be the first time they've had that. That is the big job of the dolls and all the things. Okay. This project has been going on here at St. Andrews since 2007. It was delivered to us by the presbytery at that time from the Church in Action Committee and has continued ever since. The needs continue, and the jumpers and hats and often blankets have been added to our shipments. The project, which began with I Cross Canada, and that means the International Community for the Relief of Starvation and Suffering, is now part of the Compassionate Resource Warehouse in Victoria, British Columbia. There are several groups and churches working with the Compassionate Resource Warehouse as groups working together fill containers more quickly to reach those in need. The philosophy of the Compassionate Resource Warehouse matches that of ICROSS. The Compassionate Resource Warehouse is also an all-volunteer organization, and faithful, dedicated volunteers from many backgrounds and experiences collect, sort, clean, repair, and load all the items that are shipped overseas. It is a good match with ICROSS. The recipients of the goods are pre-arranged, and the shipment is monitored until it gets to its destination. This is done to ensure that none of the goods reach the black market. These knitted items are not the only goods delivered to and packed by the volunteers in Victoria. Other goods, such as furniture from hotels and cruise ships, hospital beds from hospitals replacing beds, manufacturers donate overstocks, and so on. The dolls and soft items are also packed between them for shipping. I would like to say thank you to all our knitters, and to those who donate stuffing, and to those who have given yarn and financial donations. Also, a thank you to the quilters who now pay for the shipping to Victoria. That is what this project is all about, all of you who do it. The information in this article has been gathered from the public website of the Compassionate Resource Warehouse and the ICROSS Canada public website. And just in addition to that, I have left patterns for the jumpers and for the dolls out on the bulletin board. If anyone is interested in beginning to support the project, you are welcome to do that. Thank you.
Thank you.
have so much to be grateful for here. I just looked at this before, and look how brilliant these little jumpers are. So the little arms go out there, there's a spot for the head, and then it can fit a teeny baby, or as they grow, it can still fit them in different ways. They're pretty brilliant, I have to say. And you should take a minute to come and look at all of the dolls and all the things that have been knitted and the photo albums at the back of the church, because again, we have so much to be grateful for. Also, I hear we have an exciting announcement from Linda and Al, I think. Do you folks have a new grandbaby this week? Congratulations. And from all of this gratitude, this is why we give in return for all that we have. We give because we love. And it's the love that will make this world a better place. And so financial gifts can be made in the offering plates at the back of the church. You can e-transfer the church office, or you can click the donate button on our website. Let us pray. God bless our offerings, that they may be used to answer the cries of the world. In your name, amen.
So as we offer our prayers today, we are going to sing a response, which will be on the screen, I believe. There we are. Thank you. So let us sing that first, and then we'll pray. With us through all time and space, and calls us out to be midwives of your reign of love. We thank you for all whose faith and dedication have nurtured this community, both long ago and recently, remembering especially all who have gone home to you in this past year, and all who mourn their passing. We praise you for the varied ministries of your people here, that through them others may know your love. Set our hearts ablaze once again and fill us with the joy of serving you. Remind us that we are called together by Christ as a community of broken but hopeful believers, loving what he loved, living what he taught, and striving to be faithful servants of God in our time and place. Deepen our faith, we pray. Breathe your spirit into our spirits and lead us on in peace and hope, confident in the life you offer and the love you pour out upon us.
Send us love, send us power, send us grace.
creating God, give us the courage to seize this Kairos moment for the transformation and renewal of this world you so love. Open our hearts to wonder, awe, and gratitude so that we may live with respect in creation, loving all that you have created. Give us reverence for the wisdom of indigenous peoples. Remind us that our lives are entwined in this web of life without which we cannot survive. Guide, we pray, all those who have power and authority on earth. Give them eyes to perceive the truth, hearts to love, and intelligence, wisdom, to respond with the necessary speed for the sake of all life and to fulfill their moral duty. May these leaders heed the demands of the young, who are deeply fearful and anxious about the future and angry at lack of action. For the young, we pray for your blessing of perseverance that will give them hope. We pray for the healing of our own and the world's brokenness. We pray for safe homes, food, water, and medicines for the millions of refugees who are fleeing violence or climate and economic disasters. Bless all who bring aid to those in need, often in dangerous situations. Protect, we pray, those in our own nation, province, and town who are homeless or marginalized in any way, all who have insufficient money for the essentials of life. Empower us to advocate for systemic changes, for justice and equity, and for peace throughout Earth. We pray for indigenous peoples who have been ignored, abused, oppressed through colonization, whose lands continue to be exploited. In Canada, we pray for action on the recommendations of the Truth and Reconciliation and of the Missing and Murdered Indigenous Women and Girls Commission. Heal all the isms, such as racism and sexism, lurking within our own hearts, those attitudes which hurt and divide. Give courage and support to all who are troubled, grieving, or sick in body, mind, or spirit, and to those who care for them. We name those now in the silence of our hearts and pray also for our own needs. Bless this congregation and all who give leadership here, especially Shannon. Grant, we pray, to all for whom we pray, whatever grace is needed. Ever-loving God, we pray that you will lead each one of us to seek justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly in your way. Bless us, we pray, in all our efforts. And so we pray together as Jesus taught us in these words on the screen. Eternal Spirit, Earth Maker, Pain Bearer, Life Giver, Source of all that is and all that shall be, Father and Mother of us all, loving God in whom is heaven, The hallowing of your name echo through the universe. The way of your justice be followed by the peoples of the world. Your heavenly will be done by all created beings. Your commonwealth of peace and freedom sustain our hope and come on earth. With the bread we need for today, feed us. In the hurts we absorb from one another, forgive us. In the times of temptation and test, strengthen us. From trials too great to endure, spare us. From the grip of all that is evil, free us. For you reign in the glory of the power that is love, now and forever. Amen.
Margaret, it's so wonderful to have you with us today. On behalf of the congregation, I just wanted to thank you for your message. It was really wonderful to listen to what you had to say and to relive some of those memories. And as you talk about being a midwife and birthing new things, I think about all of the wonderful things that you've brought to us. And I look at our open hearts and open minds, and it's so nice to see you wearing that today. And you also mentioned the beginning of our work of inclusion at St. Andrew's, and you were certainly at the very roots of that. So thank you very much for everything, and thank you for being with us today.
And now go gladly into the world. Be filled with the love of God. Dance to the song of the Spirit. Befriend the Christ in each new day. And may the God who dances in creation, who embraces us with human love, who shakes our lives like thunder, bless us and drive us out with power to fill the world with her justice. Amen.